Hello, friends. Reid Duke here, and what a great day it is because it is Lord of the Rings Tales of Middle-earth release day on both Magic Online and Magic Arena. So what I'm going to do is play through a three-round draft on Magic Online. Remember that you can pair this with both free and CFP Pro written content by going to the website. We actually have some awesome news coming for you on Thursday, June 22nd. So be sure to check us out at the website on that day if you can. Thanks also to Ultimate Guard for being a longtime supporter of me and my teammates and my content. And thank you for being here. What do you say we get to some games? All right, so Elven Chorus is one that I did have during the early access event. It overperformed my expectations. I think it's very, very good. So I might take that. Mary, I think, is quite good. And in terms of commons, Smite the Deathless would be the standout. So yeah, here's a good example pick of, like, I think the really safe, surefire pick would be Smite the Deathless. However, Elven Chorus has a high upside card. I also like to kind of speculate on these unusual rares early in the format because I'm going to have plenty of opportunity to know exactly how good Smite the Deathless is, whereas how many opportunities am I going to have to play with Elven Chorus? I don't know. So let me go ahead and take Elven Chorus and we'll have some fun. So following up with a strong green card in Stew the Conies, I'm not sure I would really consider anything besides that. Let me just take a moment to adjust my sound so we're not getting that annoying alert every time. Oh, wow. So this was clearly a very, very strong pack, as I think Eomer and Quick Beam are both among the strongest non-rares in the format. But getting pick three Quick Beam when I'm drafting mono green is sort of dream come true. Yeah, there's just no reason to overthink this. Let's do it. Somebody will probably have a good red deck downstream for me, because if you recall, one of my packs, the best card was Smite the Deathless. Now the best card is Eomer for pick four. But that's okay. I'm happy in my lane here. So here, I don't think Brandywine Farmer or Pippin's Bravery are cards that I need to spend high picks on. Ents Fury is fine. I do want to make the point that this is weaker than Stew the Conies and also weaker than similar cards have been in previous formats, like, for example, Cosmic Hunger in March of the Machine. The weaknesses of Ents Fury is it's a fight rather than a bite, so your creature takes damage, and it's a sorcery. But still, you know, this is the effect that green needs to kill off opposing creatures, so I'm going to want to have, you know, so let's say one copy in my deck of Ents Fury. What else would I consider? Oath of the Grey Host. This is a way to generate three token creatures, which is good to go wide with the Elven Chorus for the mana purposes. Not as good to be a non-creature that I can't cast off the top. I guess I'm just going to take the Ents Fury. And now I notice green drying up a little bit. I don't think I'm going to take Revive the Shire. Also, when I have Elven Chorus, I really just want to have a super, super high creature count and minimize any non-creature spells in my deck, unless they're essential, like a Stew the Conies. So I could see, well, I say that, but there's not really any great creature in this pack for me to take, but I'm just saying a marginal card like Revive the Shire might not even make the cut in the finished product. I think Morgul Knife Wound is probably the best card here. Yeah, I'll take the Morgul knife wound and we'll just see what happens. All right, long list of the Ents. Here's an example of that sort of like marginal quality non-creature card that I'm probably just going to wind up cutting at the end if I have Elven Chorus. So I'd be more interested in taking Lothlorien Lookout or Mushroom Watchdogs. Of the two, the Lookout is going to be better in blue-green elves because of the scry synergies. The Watchdogs is going to be better in white-green because of the food synergies or just like slightly better beatdown card in general. Mushroom Watchdogs is probably also better in black-green as black does have some food stuff. Just a very simplistic thing. I have one food card and zero scry card so far. Let's go ahead and take the Watchdogs. Now I have a shot at a second Morgul knife wound. I have Elven Farsight. Once again, I want to keep the creature count high with the Elven Chorus, so I'd probably only play Elven Farsight if I was doing a blue-green Scry's Matter type of thing. Or, you know, it's never a bad card. If I just ended up with 21 playables and wanted to throw in an Elvish Farsight, that would never be a disaster. But I think I'll take another Morgul knife wound. Now, things drying up. I could take Pippin's Bravery, just very unexciting. Fog on the Barrow Downs, if I do transition into white-green, would be a removal spell kind of like in the same, on the same power level as the Morgul Knife Wound. Goblin Fireleaper, I'd say, is the best creature, but not strong enough to move into red for. I'll take the Fog. And another Fog or a average quality green creature. But you know what? An average quality green creature is just what I want if I'm building an Elven Chorus deck. So I'm actually going to take the Mirror Guardian over Fog on the Barrow Downs. It's just the standout best card remaining in the pack, I think. This is actually good. It's just a good card. It's a good card too. Yeah, I guess I'll take the Uruk-hai Berserker. So looking at after pack one, I'm green with black as a most likely second color, but I also have a red card and I guess two white cards. By the way, Revive the Shire is, I think, a totally fine card. It's even pretty exciting with double Morgul Knife Wound, but I just don't want non-creatures. In like my ideal Elven Chorus deck has 17 or 18 creatures, and the non-creature spells I want to be, you know, those premium removal spells that are really playing an important role. All right. Okay, so this Eowyn is kind of like a big game hunter type of effect where she just has good stats in general and then comes down and kills a powerful creature. It is two off colors, but I could certainly envision playing white-green and then splashing red. I already have the Oliphant. Alternatively, there's Legolas. There's Ranger's Firebrand. This would make my deck, but it's not strong enough to spend a first pick on. So I think it's got to be... Well, thing is, I don't have a reason to be in blue yet. So I should take either Eowyn or the Ranger's Firebrand. Yes, I'll take Eowyn and we'll just see what happens. So So had I taken Legolas, I would take Arwen here. But as it stands, I'm going to take Stew the Conies. If I was 100% to be black, I could see taking Grima or Claim the Precious. But I think I'm 100% to play green and not anywhere close to 100% to play black. So I'll take Stew the Conies. And at this point, I probably don't need to take any more Ents Furies, as two of the good version and one of the medium version is probably plenty. So I'm actually kind of like green with anything besides blue as a second color. And then if I do wind up in green, white, or green, red, I can splash Eowyn. Yikes, that is a black-green card. Shelob is just huge, huge creature. Whenever another creature dealt damage this turn by a spider you control dies, create a token that's a copy of that creature. Okay, so basically I have a massive creature that has to be chump-blocked, and then when they chump-block, I get food tokens. Saruman is also busted, one of the best non-rares in the set. There's also Chance Met Elves, Woe's Pathfinder, Morgul Knife Wound. So I think, you know, basically the Woe's Pathfinder would be great, and how excited am I about Shelob? I think I'm excited. I mean, I think that's just going to be the biggest thing on the battlefield, and nothing can get into combat with it. What other spiders are in the set? There is the 1/1 Death Touch, so I suppose I should pick those up if I'm able to. But it looks like we're heading back into the black-green territory. Elven Farsight over not much, or I could take Olyphant in case there's some turn of events where I wind up wanting to splash red. Yep, just take the marginal creature over the marginal non-creature. Entish Restoration. I could have a really nice red-white deck or like a base red beatdown deck. But Entish Restoration helps me get up to my 6-mana cards. Could also help with a splash if I decide to do that. I think it's just a good card. There's the Mirkwood Spider for my Shelob deck. Now, 4/5 trample where the ring tempts me, or 3/2 trample where the ring tempts me. I think I'll just take the cheaper one. Okay, I feel like I have some direction now. How many Morgul Knife Wounds would I play with? Shelob's Ambush, I'm pretty sure I would only sideboard. Knife Wound's probably better than Ents Fury. Doors of Durin. Whenever you attack, scry 2. Then you may reveal a top card of your library. If it's a creature card, put it on the battlefield tapped and attacking. Until your next turn, it gains trample if you control a dwarf, hexproof if you control an elf. That's quite powerful. No doubt about it. Faramir is also quite powerful. Nazgul. Another Stew the Conies. Dunland Creebane. So my inclination is I should just take a strong on-color card over a strong off-color card, which would mean that the Doors of Durin or the Faramir. Of course, I could splash. You know, I have the Entish Restoration of the Olifant, but I'm kind of leaning towards the Nazgul. Nice Death Touch creature, very good with Stew the Conies. I think it's better than the Creebane. Yep. All right, Nazgul it is. Oh, Old Man Willow, such a big payoff for being in black and green. Once again, could have a nice red-white deck. Golem is also just great, but Old Man Willow, I think, is just like outstanding. Oh, one thing I did not really mention or factor in is having Quick Theme, I think, should move the needle a little bit in terms of drafting other tree folk. Like, that makes Old Man Willow good. There was a pick earlier where I took the Uruk-hai Berserker over the Enraged Horn. Maybe if I had thought about having Quick Beam, I would have taken the tree folk instead, but no use crying over spilled milk, as they say. Wow, man. Could have had a super sweet red-white deck. As it stands, there's not a whole lot for me. Snarling Warg is okay, and it's a creature. I guess I'll take that. All right, just crappy 2-drop over the Ranger's Firebrand. I did know that red was open in pack 1, so it stands to reason it would be open in pack 3 as well. Oh my god. Just every pack has an insane red card. But this is really good for me. I needed a 2-drop, and this is kind of a perfect one. How do I feel about many partings? I think it seems good. The Mordor Trebuchet is a good card, but it's not very good for my deck. It's more like black-red kind of card. Go for a many partings. Okay, Generous Ent. That's perfect. It's a tree folk. Just what I want. So this deck, I'll probably 16 lands with the many partings and the 2 land cyclers. So we're looking to cut like third copy of Morgul Knife Wound, maybe the Brandywine Farmer, it's a pretty weak card, maybe the Snarling Warg. Can play the Elven Farsight if I choose to do that. We have Rise of the Witch King. Looks good to me. Bag End Porter is fine. Enraged Horn. I'm not going to main deck any of these, so probably the Bombadil's Song is the strongest sideboard card. Okay, I think this deck is pretty decent. So if I think about going, say, 9/7 in favor of forests with 16 lands, I'm gonna play the many partings. And I think the Entish Restoration is good. So then I need one more cut. Seven. I think I like playing two out of the three knife wounds. So then I'm cutting, I guess, just the mirror guardian. And let's get to it. Yeah, I feel pretty good about the way I drafted. I don't think any of the marginal options would have really made a difference. The main way my draft could have been different is, of course, if I had just gone red. You know, an alternative universe where I had first picked the Smite the Deathless over the Elven Chorus. But given, you know, that I had a strong start in green, I think it's pretty hard to find my way into red-white. Maybe red-green, though, and then I could have had Doors of Durin and tried that out. So a land-heavy hand, but, you know, it's a good one. So I could, you know, in theory, block and trade. But I think if I can get the Old Man Willow out, And this just gets free kills on opposing creatures. That's totally ridiculous. I mean, I'm against a blue-green deck. Like, if this thing gets to attack, I feel like my opponent's just going to concede. Sack the food token, kill your creature. Well, at least I get to power up the Entish Restoration. And yeah, just go ahead and main phase this. Oh, wow. Very weird. Very weird resolution of that. This looks like a bug. Because what it did was, I'm sure that this is not the way Entish Restoration is supposed to resolve according to the rules, but it basically, when I had a four power Old Man Willow, when I cast this, part of the resolution was sacrificing a land, which made this a 3-3. But then it had me basically resolve both modes to get two lands and then to get three lands. Very, very bizarre. I think Magic Online was kind of just confused. So here we're looking at 6, 8, 9, 13 with the quick beam. So I'm pumping the smaller creatures because this allows them to attack and offer a trade against the Grey Havens Navigator. Okay, so it changes here. Can bring in the third knife wound. I am on the draw against a deck that potentially could be pretty fast. That seems like the only change I'm likely to make. So yeah, it could just cut, you know, slightly bigger, clunkier card and play the extra knife wounds. Do I want to cut bag end porter? Yeah, that's fine. This hand looks kind of sketchy, but when you see the Forest Cycler and then the Mana Dork, I think it's actually a fine keep. So we'll go for the same turn three Old Man Willow. Opponent scry to the top, by the way. So we try again with the Old Man Willow. I also have the Shelob plus Mirkwood Spider plus Stew the Conies combo in the long run. All right, that's the Old Man Willow, that's fine. I think I'm gonna prioritize the many partings so that I can slam the six drop next turn guaranteed. Double soothing. Well, let's keep going. I'm going to choose to cast the Mirkwood Spider instead of the Easterling Vanguard. Just feel like the Spider is a really good roadblock against the blue-green deck. Wow. So what am I going to take? 7 here, unless I choose to trump block. So if I take 7, then my opponent can just kill me next turn with this. That is, unless I leave up food token. All right, I'll take it. The next turn, just Old Man Willow, Mirkwood Spider, food token, pass with 3 blockers. The unfortunate thing is, like, my opponent has so much card selection that I, you know, between the scrying and the looting, that I effectively know they're going to play a strong card every single turn. Yep. Yep. So I have to pump the brakes and not attack with the Watcher. Just use the food token. Okay, and 0 cards left for the opponent. So it's just all about what they draw next turn. I think I'm going to play everything besides Shelob, because the nightmare would be like my opponent having something that both makes this unblockable and gives them level 4 Ring Bearer, and then I would just die. Okay. So I'm going to double block the Chance Bet Elves, and I'm going to stew the Conies, the Watcher. So I could attack here because my opponent can't really block against the threat of the 7-mana activation. But I think I'm going to choose to just leave this back in case Shellop gets answered. Then I might need a blocker. I don't think the 1 damage is going to be super meaningful here. All right, got a win. I'll see you for round 2. And I'm back for match number 2 with green-black. Shall we call it green-black tree folk in Lord of the Rings draft? I'm going to keep this hand. It's very unexciting, but it has potential. Like, if my first 4 draw steps are lands, then it's going to be awful. But if I draw even 1 creature that costs, you know, between 3 and 5 mana, it's going to be a good hand. Technically a non-land. Also technically a non-land. Sure, no blocks. Also technically a non-land, but we're getting real technical at this point, as most of these cards have just been mana sources. I think I'm just going to block the Uruk-hai with the spider and not cast anything. No, that is such a beating. All right, all right, all right. Okay, well, 6 drop creature. Can't complain about that. Ah, discarded a blue card, so have some Esper stuff going on the other side of the battlefield.
So if my opponent attacks, I'm just going to offer the trade and have stew the conies in case something bad happens. This does mean giving them a loot, but I think it's worthwhile to save my removal spell in hand. Discarded Sam's Desperate Rescue, so that's, I mean, hopefully just because they're a little bit choked on black mana, not because their hand is outrageously strong. Okay, so level 4 Ring Bearer. Little help here. Okay, okay. So they could, if they wanted to, just pay 2 life every turn to have this as an attacker that that loots. And they're gonna do it so far. Golem's Bite. I guess I shouldn't have pressed F6. Drawing pretty well, I'd say, on balance in this game. Like, a few of my draw steps were unexciting, like the search for lands cards when I was already a little bit flooded, but my last few draw steps have been good, so no complaints here. So why would I not block the Took Reaper, representing, I mean, Shell Ops Ambush as a 2-for-1 trade? I'm just going to block. Orcish Bowmasters. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to attack. I'm going to play Uruk-hai Berserker. And then I think I'm going to go first do the conies on the token before it can be declared as an attacker. That thing is unblockable. It deals me 4 per turn. It allows my opponent to loot, so it's pretty scary on balance. Let's think about what spells could blow me out. Golem's Bite and Hobbit Sting could both kill the Berserker. So I'm going to use the Ent to kill the Orc Army. Sweet. So more or less looking at the same sideboarding change, the Morgul Knife Wound in and the clunky creature out. You know, Brandywine Farmer might actually be good in the matchup because it blocks well and gains me 6 life. yeah, I could see all of that being worthwhile. Ugh, this is the scary thing about the card Many Partings is, like, if I had Forest, Forest, Swamp, my hand would be virtually perfect. But since I have Swamp, Swamp, Many Partings, I might get mana screwed. But looking at the three cheap black cards I'm going to keep, I think just these five cards is enough to keep. And then if I draw one Forest, then I effectively have two Forests. So this is a fine hand on the draw. My opponent mulligan to six ahead of me. And never didn't have it. So they could have Golem's Bite to respond to sacrificing the food token. I guess I'll play around it. Just not use the food until they're tapped out. Mordor Muster and no other play does kind of look like a Golem's Bite. All right, I'm just going to attack first. Because my thinking is, if I play the Nazgul, it resolves, then they Golems Bite the Mushroom Watchdogs, then I'm stuck without a Ring Bearer. But if they're going to use the Golems Bite in combat, then I can play the Nazgul post-combat. Also, my hand is not such that I really desperately need to loot right away. And they did indeed have the Golem's Bite. Now they can have Hobbit Sting. But I guess this thing's kind of useless if I don't sacrifice the food token, so let's go for that. No effects. Sure. So we're going to trade. We're going to take three. No big deal. Great Hall of the Citadel. Add 2 mana in any combination of colors, only to cast legendary spells. Well, with only one card in hand before drawing, my opponent's going to need something pretty special here. Looks like those two cards were played in the wrong order. Interesting. So discard the troll, then play the knife wound and the Entish Restoration. So I think the proper sequencing here is let them resolve the knife wound ability, see what they choose to do, and then before they draw, cast the restoration. So I wouldn't want to lose this to a removal spell, not that it's the end of the world either way, but just talking about optimal sequencing. The small decisions matter in a game of Magic. 2, 3. So if, yeah, I do want to pump this up because otherwise it just trades against the spirit token. Remember, they're not dead because they can use the food to go up to 12. But if this game does somehow continue, the Elven Chorus feels like it'll be good enough to get me over the finish line. They forgot to sack the food before damage, so that's going to be me going to 2-0, and I'll see you for round 3. And I'm back for the third and final round, playing for my first ever Lord of the Rings draft trophy, and I have an excellent hand. What I'd really love to pick up is a land cycler, like, say, a Generous Ent. And then the Rise of the Witch King could help me reanimate that ahead of schedule. But it looks like even just, you know, curving into my big creatures will be pretty effective here. If I hadn't drawn this, then I might have played Easterling Vanguard to trade and then play this on turn 3. And I still don't miss a beat with my 4 and 5, with my 5 and 6. But having drawn the 4 drop, I'll just skip this spot on my curve and go straight to the Bag End Porter. Hobbit Sting. I will block. Sure. So here's the thing. Normally you'd make your smallest creature into the Ring Bearer, but if and when I cast Rise of the Witch King, I'm going to sacrifice the Orc army. So maybe I should just choose something else. I mean, does it really matter? No, it does. Well, it matters because of the Bag End Porter getting +1/+1. But okay, I'll choose the Orc army. Plus one, plus zero, and gain first strike. Wow, that's very powerful here. But I guess it's not that good because it allows this to attack, but it stops this from attacking. So kind of break even. Okay, so this attack's uncontested. This attack's a 5-5. This attack's a 4-5. I think I'm going to send everything and just try to race because I'm going to get a food token, which will be pretty nice. That is just a chump block. Interesting. Okay, I don't think that changes anything. I think I'm still not on the Rise of the Witch King plan just yet. Could sack the food to make a 3-3, and then it threatens to block, but they can always equip. I think this is just fine as a chump blocker. And the food for the 3 life is going to be more valuable. I see. I wouldn't have been able to block as a 3-3 anyway because this was going to go up to 5-4 based on the ability. Yep. Errand Rider. Great card. Not equipping the bow, which is suspicious. So what do you have? Like Stew the Conies? Something that comes at instant speed and costs 3 or 4 mana. Well, let's make them have it. If you have nothing, then these two creatures attack for 14, and that's lethal. Is there any need to get in with the Ring Bearer? Anything that... Yeah, I think it's good. I think it's good. Hooray, quick beam. All right, one game win away from a league trophy. Yeah, I mean, I've brought in the Morgul Knife Wound every time. One land with a many partings and a forest cycler. That's actually plenty, so this is a fine hand. Aragorn, company leader, 3 mana, 3/3. Whenever the ring tempts you, you get a bonus on Aragorn. All right, powerful card for when the ring tempts you. Fire off the knife wound, or I could stick with the plan of Entish Restoration. The problem is, if I do the knife wound, then I kind of have no play the following turn. So I'd prefer to just curve into the tree folk. So I'll pass, but very scary to leave a rare like this sticking around. Granted, my opponent needs both another creature and a way to be tempted by the ring before it's truly scary. Bag End Porter. You got it. Nice. I spooked them. Tax is a 5/5. So I could now fire off double knife wound. They kept Aragorn, ditched the Bag End Porter. Incoming Generous Ent. So they now have a lifelinking ring bearer. Oh yeah, I guess Aragorn is an effective blocker. That's fair enough. So a little bit of a wasted attack there with the Vanguard, but not the end of the world. They just keep paying the two. Okay, you're gonna Hobbit Sting my Berserker. That's fine. Try to kill that stalwart. Oh, no. All right. Well, that was a certified disaster. Guess I just have to pump the brakes now and stop attacking. So the obvious block is just generous ent on the stalwarts. I can also choose to multi-block. Well, this is an interesting game because this is the first time I've seen someone just suck up a Morgul knife wound and just take the damage every single turn for the whole game. Here they're going to Hobbit Sting, but I still get a pretty favorable trade there. I'm not in terrible shape. And I can get a level 3 Ring Bearer to start looting if I need to. So both players with level 3 Ring Bearers. This thing gains first strike. It's not bad because I can still double block it. That's not really a problem. I can make a huge watchdogs, but I'd rather keep the spider and then just sack the food tokens. The card I really want for a game like this is Elven Chorus. But I guess that's something about Elven Chorus. If it's too far down in your library, it's kind of too late. So level 4 Ring Bearer doesn't really do much here. So they have the blockers. But yeah, I think I start by attacking. Just go ahead and trade this off. Old Man Willow. Yeah, discard Nazgul. Keep the Old Man Willow. I have a block lined up with the Orc army. That's a good trade for me. All right, I guess I'm just going to play my forest and attack for seven. I was holding lands because, in theory, if I get a ring bearer, then I can loot them away, but I don't have a ring bearer, so I'd rather just hit really hard with the Old Man Willow. At a certain point, they're probably going to choose to block with Aragorn. There it is. 15 cards left in my library. So I can just attack with Old Man Willow again. I could attack with Old Man Willow plus Spider. Or I could attack with all three, sack the food on the horn. Let's assume Aragorn's going to chump the Old Man Willow. I think I just attack with Old Man Willow. That should be enough. I think definitely leaving the spider on defense is a good move. Could just be a turn away here. Oh, baby. Oh, baby. All right, and we've done it. Green-black tree folk for my first ever Lord of the Rings draft trophy. Thanks for being here with me, and I'll see you next time here on ChannelFireball.com.